here to talk today about personalized search and recommendations. I am the chief data scientist at Dice.com. I work on a data science and analytics team under Yuri. Dice is the leading US job board for technology professionals. So like CareerBuilder and Monster, we're a job site, but unlike them, we just specialize in IT jobs for folks like yourselves. Some of the key projects I've worked on at Dice are recommender engines, some of which you'll see today, how they work. I also worked on the Dice Salary Predictor, the Career Pathing Tool, and the Skills Pages, and I'm currently getting a PhD in DePaul in my part time. So we recently released a salary prediction tool for free on our website. You can go to our homepage, go to the Career Explorer link, and you'll see the salary tool. It will attempt to predict your salary based on our years of resume data. So given your title, your skills, your experience, it will tell you what we think you're worth. Not only that, it will tell you what the best skills to learn for your salary, to maximize your salary. Similarly, we have a career pathing tool that will suggest relevant career paths for you. So it will show you the most common career transitions for your job title, but it will also allow you to look at other transitions that are relevant, but will also optimize your salary or make you more in demand. And we also have our skills pages, which show you information about technology skills. Okay, so a brief outline of my talk. I will be talking about relevancy feedback and the ratio algorithm. I will going over implementation details, how we've built this as a request handler in Solr, how we do entity extraction. I will also talk about conceptual semantic search, how we can achieve this with this plugin, how we do real-time recommendations on the site with this plugin, how we can extend it to do personalized search, and also some other use cases such as query and filter suggestions. Okay, my motivation for this talk, in past years I've talked about more complicated machine learning approaches that require some knowledge of data science or machine learning and some of the languages. So some people have found this hard to use because they may not be a data scientist or a Python expert. And so this time I wanted to talk about a plugin that we've built and used in production that's very easy for you guys to consume if you want. We've open sourced it. You can drop it into your Solr server and use it as a request handler and hopefully have some use out of it yourselves. So there are two main problems in achieving relevancy. There's the problem of ambiguity or polysemy, where words or phrases can have multiple meanings. This causes problems with precision. And then there's the problems of synonymy. So when you have words or phrases, many of which have the same meaning, but the same term is expressed differently in different ways. And that causes problems with recall. So there's two types of solution to this problem. There are global methods and local methods. So what you see mostly in this conference is people talking about what are called global methods. They adjust the query based on some analysis of either the entire index or some other data set. Some examples are learning to rank, probabilistic query parsing, synonyms, conceptual search, and so on. But another approach exists called local methods. And local methods differ in that they look at the results in your index to a given query, and they try to improve relevancy by taking those results and using them to improve the results that come back in future. And this is termed relevancy feedback. I haven't seen it talked about much at this conference, so I wanted to bring it to your attention today. And this can be used to improve precision by doing regular relevancy feedback, and there's a variation called blind feedback that can be used to improve recall. Okay, so relevancy feedback, supervised relevancy feedback uses information from the user's profile or search behavior to adjust the search results and trying to improve precision of the results. Unsupervised or blind feedback instead uses co-occurrence information between the query terms and the most relevant documents to that query to expand the query and improve recall. Both of these mechanisms can be implemented quite easily as a simple Solr plugin using the ratio algorithm. So the relevancy feedback process works like this. The user issues a short query. The system returns an initial set of results to that query. The results are then annotated as to whether they're relevant or not to the query. The annotation can be done by a human, or it can be done using automatic methods, or it can be done using signals that you have about the user. And we'll talk about that in a second. We then take those relevant documents and we use them to create a better query by figuring out query expansion terms from those documents. And then that hopefully better query is then re-executed with those terms and you get better results. So here's a visual diagram kind of explain this process. So the Rocio algorithm is typically used for both forms of relevancy feedback. So given a set of relevant documents for a query, we use these documents to compute a query vector. And that query vector is computed in such a way that it is much closer to the relevant documents than the original query was. And then we use this vector to formulate a new query. So this can be visually depicted like this, my rather colorful handmade diagram. So on the left there, you have the initial query, which is a blue box. And then it was executed, the results within the circle were returned. The green triangles are the relevant documents, the red squares are the irrelevant documents. What we want to do is then take that query, modify it, and move it to the left so it's closer in the sort of semantic space, the vector space, to the relevant documents and further away from the irrelevant ones. And then on the right, we re-execute the query and we get more green triangles and less red squares, so yay, hopefully it's worked. Okay, so you want to go back, okay? All right, so there's two ways to get this relevancy feedback. There are, we can gather explicit feedback from the user, or we can get implicit feedback from the user. Explicit feedback can be as simple as asking them what is relevant, which documents are relevant to your query, but you can also use other data that you have about them. So maybe you know products they've purchased before in the past, maybe for us, we have their jobs that they've applied to, where we have concrete signals that we know that those documents are relevant to the person. Then there's implicit feedback. So here we use data that's easier to capture, doesn't require any effort from the user, but provides a much weaker signal. So a common example would be clickstream data. We can look at, for a given query, we can look at which documents they clicked on, which ones they viewed, which ones they spent more time on, which ones they hovered their mouse over. There's many different ways to gather information that gives you a softer signal as to what is relevant. Each of those signals on our own may not be very useful, but in aggregate, they can provide a pretty good signal without any effort from the user. So to implement this, we built two solo plugins that are based very loosely on the MLT handler, but with a very different algorithm and a lot more functionality. So key to this working for us has been to configure a number of fields in Solr that contain only relevant entities in our domain. And those are job titles and skills, essentially. And then when we execute a query, we take all those entities from those two fields, and then we score them using a TF-IDF score, and then we take the top scoring terms for each field from those whitelisted fields. So we take those terms, the top terms for each field, we weight them by the TF-IDF score. We then normalize the weights of those terms within each field so that the aggregate of those terms has the same impact on the resulting query. So we take a unit length norm of the vector in Mappy speak. We then apply any per field boosts based on the configuration of the request handler. We apply a per field boost on top of those terms so that we ensure that, for example, the title terms, the total title query has twice the impact, say, of the skills query. And that renormalization means that it doesn't matter how many terms in each of those fields match, we make sure that they have the relative impact on the resulting query, that the title is always more important, if it has two terms, if it has 10 terms. And a number of internal tests using this in the recommendation scenario, and we have a lot of other use cases for this, but as a recommender, it outperforms the default MLT handler quite well, especially when we compare it using these extracted terms versus just raw text. So to extract the important keywords, we use what I would call naive entity extraction. So we're basically just looking for keywords and phrases in text documents without any more sophisticated parsing. There's a number of ways you can do this. You can do it outside of Solr using the Solr text tagger, and a number of companies use that, and I hear very good things about that tool. It's very fast, it uses an FST. We wanted to do it inside of Solr for several reasons, as will become apparent. So we use a sequence of synonym filters to a whitelist of terms we want to keep. Then when Solr processes a synonym, it adds some metadata that says this is of type synonym in the token. We then use a type filter to filter the resulting tokens down to just those that we want to keep. You could also use a keep word filter to do this. This is also very fast. It also uses the synonym filter also uses an FST to do this. This is what the analysis chain looks like. That's more for reference purposes. And this is what it looks like in the analysis window in Solr. So you can see I have this sort of long sentence. Pass it through the analysis chain, and then we get out. At the end of it, we get SQL Server, SQL, and Apache Hadoop. It's thrown away I love, biking, and movies, that terms that we don't think are relevant to our domain, and it's standardized SQL Server to Microsoft SQL Server, and so on. OK, so demo number one. So thank God my laptop now works. OK, so if a user on our site does a search for video game engineer, oh, and you can't see that. OK, now you can see it. So if a user on a site does a search for video game engineer, without use of this algorithm, you'll get a lot of matches for video engineer and other engineering roles that are not to do game development. So if the user did the search and they started clicking on the ones that they felt were relevant to the query, so let's click on the first and the fourth results. So skipping over video engineer, skipping over game designer, because it's a game developer role. Let's click on that one too. Those three documents are then sent to the relevancy feedback handler. The top terms on the left are extracted. So it's extracted the title term, video game developer, as a single token. And these skill terms, game development and mathematics, 3D computer graphics. The weights of those terms and phrases represented by the size of the blue bar. Then using those phrases and those weights, it's constructed a query, re-executed it, and you get the results on the right there. So as you can see, we're on the left here, we get a lot of matches that are irrelevant or partly relevant, like games designer. On the right here, we get only games developer jobs. So the green arrow means that this result has been promoted, and then the number means by how many ranks it's been promoted. So the top results moved up 11 ranks. And you'll see here there's also some new documents that were not returned by the original query, but are nonetheless relevant to this result set. So this one, for instance, senior software design engineer games is also relevant, even though it doesn't have video game engineer in the title. Toggle back and forth. Okay, so some use cases of relevancy feedback. So you can allow users to search from examples instead of just a query. So they can type their initial query, and then they can use the documents that they found were relevant, like the lady in that picture. And then you can re-execute the search. So that's one use case. People find it easier to show you examples of what they like often than formulate a query. So that might be a good user scenario. But it's not restricted to just that. So another thing you can do with it is you can do personal recommendations from someone's browse history. You can take the jobs they browsed or the documents they browsed, feed them into the relevancy feedback handler and get matches. And it can take multiple documents. So it's not restricted to finding a match on a single document. The TF-IDF weights are aggregated over all of the documents that are passed to it. The second form of relevancy feedback I want to talk about is blind feedback. This, again, uses the Rocio algorithm. But this time, it takes the top rank results from a given search query, and it uses those as a set of relevant documents. So rather than having the user tell us somehow that what documents are relevant or irrelevant, we instead of execute the query, take the top results. That could be 10 or 50 documents. Take the top terms from those documents and use those to run the Rocio algorithm. This is also called unsupervised feedback or pseudo-relevancy feedback. This idea dates back about 20 years, but there's many academic papers that have been published on it that show that mainly it tends to be very good in terms of relevancy. It tends to improve the relevancy of the initial search engine without using any sophisticated machine learning or global methods or anything. So it's a very simple approach to get better results. There's a performance penalty. You're executing the query twice, so bear that in mind. However, if you use some intelligent caching mechanisms, you can probably mitigate a lot of that impact. So I have to toggle again. Sync 2. OK. So here we have a demo of the blind feedback mechanism, in effect. If a user's done a search for machine learning engineer in Denver, the initial set of results are shown in the middle. Those have then been processed and analyzed, and the top title terms have been extracted, the top skills terms have been extracted. You can see it's extracting relevant terms, machine learning engineer, data scientist, computer vision, Python, natural language processing. It's then using those terms and re-executing the query, and then you get better results on the right. So we don't have any machine learning engineer jobs in Denver in this index. We do have them in San Jose and other areas. But I want to use this example to illustrate the fact that even though we don't have any documents that match that query, we can still get semantically relevant matches with this approach. So this allows you to implement something that's kind of like conceptual search or semantic search without the need for an external algorithm that runs outside of Solr to process your index. And so the results, we get data scientist, data engineer, and so on. Okay, now I'm going to talk briefly about recommendations. Then I'm going to move on to personalized search. So recommendations, if you're building a recommender engine, there's three types of recommender. There's content-based recommendations, there's collaborative filtering, and then there's a hybrid approach. Content-based recommendations use a content of some description. So for us, it could be a resume or a job description. Using that content, you can generate a query or find semantic matches somehow. Collaborative filtering, second and probably more common type of recommender engine, uses user behavior to generate recommendations. So you look at people's purchases or which jobs they've viewed or which jobs they've applied for, which products they've purchased on your e-commerce site, and using those items that they've viewed that they assume are relevant to them, you can use those to generate recommendations. The hybrid recommender combines both approaches, and a lot of all recommenders that run our site are hybrid recommenders. And all of these can be achieved in real time using our plugin. So how do we do content-based recommendations? Well, we modified a relevancy feedback handler to allow you to post a content stream via a post call. So you take the body of a document, you post it to the request handler using a post and a form field. It then takes that document, runs the entity extraction logic over it using the analysis chains, generates the Rocio query again, and then executes that to provide recommendations. We also have a parameter that allows you to do boosting to this query. So we can take a profile, use it to find matching jobs, and then we can apply a boost query so that those jobs are both relevant to the user and also geographically close to where they live. This algorithm powers a lot of the real-time recommendations on our site. We have an offline recommender that uses machine learning, runs overnight, but we also have a lot of jobs occur during the day that hit our site that won't get recommendations from that. So instead, we use this response handler to do our real-time recommendations. So again, I have to switch back. So demo number three out of four, if I have time. Okay, so here on the left, we have a raw text document. You can see there's sort of noisy HTML in there. And then this document is basically a job description for a data scientist role. We can take that job description, we can post it to the request handler. It'll go and extract these terms on the bottom, which are relevant to the query, again, using the Rocio algorithm, and then produce recommendations on the right there. However, I think this is more entertaining. What we can also do is we can go on one of our competitor sites. We can do a search for data scientist in San Jose. We can click on a job on Indeed. Hopefully the demo gods are nice to us. So we take the URL. So this response handler also takes the URL and will download the content of that web page. So provided that site doesn't block us, which I don't guarantee. Oh. And it blocked us. Let me try one more. And that one doesn't have any content. Let's try it. All right, last attempt. All right, let's try this one. Obviously, these aren't pre-canned results. All right, okay, well, this was working earlier, but obviously, it's blocking my IP now. But I promise you that does work. Okay, so we can do content-based recommendations with that response handler. We can also do collaborative filtering recommendations. You kind of saw that already with the relevancy feedback demo. You can take job IDs or document IDs and you can find matches to them. So we can do both types of recommendation. Okay, so. And finally, we can also, with some modifications, we can do personalized search. So how do we get from relevancy feedback to personalized search? Well, it's very simple. We can use the relevancy feedback query that it generates to customize a search for a user. We can do this using a boost query. So we can take the user's search that they're executing. We can take the relevancy feedback query. We can use that as a boost query, and it will boost the results to the user's query using that information. As it supports all those types of recommendations, we can use content-based information from their profile to generate that query. We can use their apply history to generate that query. Or we can even use the blind feedback handler, and we can use their previous searches to generate that query. However, if you're doing any kind of search personalization, there's one very important thing you want to bear in mind. You don't want to personalize the search for someone if that personalization information is completely irrelevant to what they're searching for. So if they're searching for accounting jobs and they are a Java developer, maybe they took a career change or for whatever reason, or maybe they're an employer on a site and yesterday they were searching for Java developers, now they're searching for accountants, we don't want to take their accounting results and turn them into Java developers because those are not related titles. But if they were searching for Java developer or they are a Java developer and they're searching for Hadoop developer, then maybe we do want to show them jobs that are kind of a blend between Java and Hadoop, or Java developers with Hadoop and so on. And how do we do this? Well, you'll notice that if you look at the most related terms in those Venn diagrams for each of those titles, Java developer and Hadoop developer have a lot of related terms in common. Java, big data, Hadoop. However, if you look at accountant and Java developer, they don't really have a lot of related terms. In fact, they probably have none. Oracle, I was kind of reaching there, but there's not much overlap between those because they're not semantically related. So what we want to do is, if we have a lot of intersection between those two queries, then we want to boost the results and personalize them. But if we don't, then we don't. We want to just leave them be. To flip back again. Well, can I just do the demo and then, because I'm sorry, I'm just running out of time, but then it'll maybe become more apparent as how you would use this. Okay, so imagine the user does a search for Hadoop one day, and they click on some results here. So Hadoop engineer, these are jobs they've viewed. They then go and do a search for an accountant position. So the search results in the middle are the regular results they would see for a search with accounting. Results on the right are the results with personalization. You'll notice that there's no difference between those two result sets. Right? So because we assume that accounting is not really related to Hadoop. So we do not want, in this case, to personalize their accounting search based on our information about them. However, if I reset this, do a search for Java, see the results in a write are quite different. Right? In the middle, without personalization, we have a lot of Java developer positions. On the right, we have Java developers that know Hadoop, or we have Hadoop developers that know Java. Right? We have top result is Hadoop admin with Java. Second result is, and the third result are ones we didn't get for the regular search without personalization. But they both have big data, Hadoop, Java as the skills. And so the results with personalization, I would argue, are much more relevant than those without it. So how do we do this? More kind of query specifics. Well, we use the boost query, plus we use a high MMM threshold. So the MMM parameter is supported by a number of query parsers in Solr and allows you to set a threshold on how many of the terms in a query match before that query will impact the relevancy ranking. So we can use a relevancy feedback query as a boost query, and we can set the boost query with a high MMM threshold, and so it'll only boost documents from that second query if most of the terms from the relevancy feedback query match. And that query has a lot of terms because we've extracted a lot of terms from those documents. So we can say like a 75% threshold. Say 75% of those terms, for example, have to match before we will boost those documents. There's about 5 different ways you can do this in Solr at least. You can use a re-ranking plugin. You can use a boost query parser. You can create a Boolean query. So the first example there is just a Boolean query. So we create a must clause on a Java developer search, which is what the user typed in. We set a high boost on that. Then the relevancy feedback query is in red. We set a much lower boost on that. And we set a threshold of 75%. So the tilde 3 means 3 of those 4 terms have to match. And that is an OR query. So it will only kick in and affect the results if 3 of those 4 terms match. Otherwise, it will leave them alone. You can also do this with the BQ, the boost query functionality, and there's many other ways to do it. So I've kind of talked about some of the use cases. So you can use any of the relevancy feedback queries that are generated by our request handlers to do this. So you can personalize it based on their profile data. You can personalize it based on their apply data, their purchase history. You can personalize it based on their previous searches using the blind feedback handler. Some other use cases, you can use those top terms that it extracts as query filter suggestions or related search suggestions in the UI without executing them. You can just use them as suggestions, or you can use them as more relevant faceting filters, for instance. There's also some ways that these approaches can be enhanced if you're interested and want to contribute to the plugin. The relevancy feedback could be enhanced by using negative terms from the negative examples. So Solr supports negative boosts, so that would be one way you could do that. The blind feedback plugin, it could be enhanced by only extracting terms close to the user's query. Rather than extracting terms from the entire document, you could just look within a window of words around the query terms in the document and only extract those. And that's also been shown to sort of improve the accuracy of this approach. It's called the positional relevance model, and I have a link to the paper in the slides there. There's an open source GitHub repo where you can download and you can use these plugins in your Solr install. I'll leave that up for a minute if you want to take pictures. And there's some references and related ideas. So basically, I've talked about the two relevancy feedback plugins that we've built, the blind feedback handler and the audience supervised feedback handler and the relevancy feedback handler, how we can use them to do recommendations. We can also use them to do conceptual search, personalization, query filter suggestions, and so on. So that's the end of the talk. And now can take some questions. Gentleman there.
So you mentioned you extract the terms from the top 10 to 50 results and then you use that to modify the query.
Yeah.
So this is kind of like chicken and egg problem, right? So first of all, the top 10 to 50 results need to be some kind of reference.
Mm-hmm.
That you can extract.
Yes, yes. It's a very naive approach. Right.
The user may be looking at only the top 10 or 20 results. So if they are already good, then what's the point to modify?
Well, I mean, you might get other documents that they never saw that are more relevant to the query, right? And that's just one of the use cases. That's the conceptual search kind of use case. So it's, you know, conceptual search, you want to pull in synonymous terms and make sure it matches to those. Like I showed, the data science jobs match the machine learning jobs. You know, so the regular, if you don't have any matches in the index for that search term, you can look at the whole index, look at the most relevant documents, add those expansion terms, and then you get more relevant results. But I mean, yeah, this, it's a somewhat naive approach. I'm not saying that is the optimal way of doing this. I'm just saying this is a very simple way. You can test it out in our plugin and then build something more sophisticated later. But it'll take you 6 months to build a machine learning model to do this. It'll take you a couple of hours to drop in our plugin and configure it probably. Over there. Yeah, so I talked about the entity extraction. So we have a list of synonyms that list titles and skills. And we have a titles field and a skills field. And then it runs those synonym files and does synonym processing and collapses across all the different variants and then sort of standardizes those titles into a single token. And then we have this little whitelisting using the type filter. So basically, it has a whitelist of terms that it expects. But we're able to use the synonyms processing to make that a much more flexible matching of those terms, too. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you.